I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. And I'm all out of bubblegum.
Go ahead. Make my day.
Cinema Royale.
Hello, welcome to Cinema Royale. I'm your host, Mike Mixtape. And this is another glorious episode. Going to talk about Don Bluth here on this episode. Special episode for Don Bluth. Let me introduce you to the awesome panel of film aficionados, a.k.a. the brother and sister of cinema. And according to my point of view, first up, we got Devin Cook, our temporary co-host.
Hi, everybody.
Hopefully not so temporary.
Yeah. Yay. Hey, I'm the cute one, the cute woman of the podcast, but I have to show these Don Bluth DVDs. I has 8 of them. Yay! DVDs!
Wow.
Yep, I have 8.
I envy you.
Yay.
She even has Titan AE.
Yep, I found Titan AE. That was an amazing find.
Yeah, but still, does it beat this one? Look at this beauty.
Oh, wow.
Look at it! Look at it! I want you to look at it!
Oh, yeah, that's true. You had your sign, you motherfucker.
I know.
And the Touché. One with the Secret of NIMH DVD is Matt Brunet, also known as Adamat.
What's up, everybody? And since today I posted a video, I just want to give you guys a bit of an update. For those of you wondering, yes, the banana is okay.
I was going to ask you that, too.
It's a nice throw. It's a nice throw you did there. It was really good.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
As long as you guys got the banana.
And
I'm very concerned about don't worry, I'm always concerned about my banana. Keep in mind, I need to take care of it. It's really big, you know.
Make sure it's wet, too.
Yeah, but is the camera okay? Do you need a tripod for your equipment?
Who cares about the camera? It's my banana that I care about.
How often do you peel your banana?
Only when it's necessary.
How often do you bite your banana?
Only when someone's hungry. Is when
one
I feel it.
Skin, two, skin, three, skin.
And the man with all the jokes, Morgan Ledger.
I will now do for you my impersonation of Eddie Murphy as Pluto Nash's clone doing an impersonation of Lenny Luthor from Batman vs. Superman. So, Superman, you finally have it figured out. Jerry?
Hmm? It's ABC Delicious.
It's Jerry.
And last but not least, James Sullivan, also known as Homitude.
Tonight's broadcast is brought to you by King Louie, now with 100% more cowbell, and Mike had no idea until after the movie.
Seriously, man, how could you not see that?
It went way over my head. I was like, wait, there's a cowbell. And then later on, I was like, goddamn.
I got it. Now, don't try to kid me, man cub. I'll make a deal with you. What I pray tell is the cowbell to make my dreams come true. Now, give me the cowbell, man cub. Come on! Clue me what you do. Give me the power of that cowbell so I can be like you. Oh, Obadoo. I want to be like you. I want to walk like you. Talk like you, you see it's true. Someone like me can't learn to be like someone like you. Alright.
Thank you, Dr. John.
And of course, the ever so grateful moment of King Louis destroying the Abe Vigoda Pagoda.
Yep.
Abe Vigoda Pagoda. There we go.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. three out of the four watched The Jungle Book. But we're not going to talk about Jungle Book. We're here to talk about Don Bluth and his many, actually, it's like few of his film work.
Fascinatingly enough, he did not work on The Jungle Book, surprisingly.
Yeah. Sadly.
That would have been an excellent connection right there.
I think he did Sleeping Beauty. I know he did The Rescuers because that feud he did with the eyes.
He did, did Sleeping Beauty, Sword in the Stone, then he had to go to his Mormon mission, but then he came back for Robin Hood to be an animator for, I believe. Then afterwards, he really got big when he directed The Small One and was the animation director for Pete's Dragon and The Rescuers. And then he just said, F it, and left.
I'm going to go make my own movie.
With blackjack and hookers.
And mice!
So, I picked a particular film that he got his little itty-bitty start away from Disney. And I even asked the guys, like, hey, is it okay I do this film? It's like, it's something worth talking about, because it's his humble beginnings as an independent animator. And so that film is, of course, the 1980 film, Xanadu.
Xanadu! Xanadu!
Where do I even start with this movie? Oh my god.
All you, Mike. All you.
All you have to start.
The ball's in your court.
It's all on Blu-ray.
Really?
Yeah, they released it last month with Batteries Not Included and Howard the Duck.
Well, damn, I wasn't expecting that. I mean, the film, and we were planning this ahead of time, and I was kind of comparing it to the recent Batman v Superman, because back then, it didn't have a great critical reception like Batman v Superman is doing now, and the creators and the stars are like, oh, you know what, the audience can say whatever they want, they can say they like it or not, but that's just a different story. Anyways, Xanadu, oh my god, what the I start watching it today, and I'm thinking, okay, what the fuck is this movie? Don Bluth's animation sequence is not even until, like, the last third of the movie, at least, like, towards the hour mark, and I'm thinking, I have to sit through an hour just to find the freaking Don Bluth animation part. It's like, okay, fine. So, it is, stars Michael Beck, Olivia Newton-John, and Gene Kelly in his last role.
Mm-hmm.
Basically.
You also forgot the amazing Cliff Richard.
Okay.
Living Doll? No?
Devil Woman?
I just never knew that person. Anyways,
I'm so showing you a music video later.
Oh, I know he will. I know Morgan will. This is a weird, weird film. I mean, it starts out with his character, Michael Beck's character, is Sonny. Fuck it. I just watched it today. What the fuck is his last name?
I don't even remember, Malone. But I watched.
Malone.
Yeah,
thank
Malone.
You. Fuck you. Thank you. Did I say fuck you?
Yes, you did.
You fucked me and thanked me? What kind of person are you? I only take quarters, bitch.
I'll put them in your coin slot.
You can start.
But it's not gonna work. I don't. I'm sorry. Didn't mean to say.
Sonny Malone, moving on.
Good night, everybody.
I'm out of here. I don't know what to do anymore.
Jack and Joe went up the hill to fetch a pail of water. Joe came down with 250, that frickin' whore.
Yeah, so, you see, I'm going. I'm going through like a bad little sick era because I'm having a cough, so if you hear me cough or rustle my voice, that's fine. Sonny Malone is a painter. He paints. Well, he quit his original job when he used to paint, you know, the album covers, you know, so he could hang on to record companies. And then he comes back to his job, blah, 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 and his boss is like, hey, I want you to paint this picture, do this picture, blah, 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 blah. But before all that happened, he's like, he's drawing stuff, he's just painting stuff, and he's like, ah, that's not going to work. Rips the paper, that's not going to work. And he draws something and rips it, and he throws it outside, and it goes gushing through the wind, and he goes, you see this mural, this painting, you know, and it's full of these
mural.
Chicks. Thank you. I'm lost for words. Can you just correct me if I'm wrong? Okay, so full of girls, you know, and all of a sudden these piece of papers, you know, they light, you know, they ignite something in these ladies, and they light up, and they start, you know, dancing, and you hear ELO, you know, Electric Light Orchestra playing, and it's just like, the fuck am I watching? What? How did that happen? It's duh. So. Then you have Olivia Newton-John. She roller skates, and she passes right by Sonny Malone. And, Sonny's like, okay, where is this chick? I gotta find this chick. I like her so much. So he goes to work at the company where they paint the pictures off the records, you know, to display in the record companies. And he discovers that one of the record albums has the girl on it, you know. It's like, how'd you get that picture? Where is she? I don't know where she is. And the photographer's like, you know, I was taking pictures of this thing and it looked really good, and all of a sudden he just appeared out of nowhere, and that one shot just hopped right into frame, and I took a picture of it. It was perfect. And I'm thinking, how the fuck does that happen? She rolls right by and she hops into that one frame and then leaves. It's like, what are you doing?
She woman? Photobombed.
She photobombed the album cover. It's just like, well, she's, and he's still on the search. Still on the search for this one chick. And then also, of course, he goes to the beach to look for her, you know, because that's where they first met, you know, walking, you know, blah, blah, blah. Meets Gene Kelly, you know, out of nowhere, just playing. I believe is like a clarinet, maybe. I don't even.
He was playing a clarinet on a rock.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So, they talk. They're like, blah, 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 blah. Let's hang out sometime. Still on the search for this one chick. And you hear, I don't know, it's just very all over the place. You know, it's like a lovey-dovey kind of thing where he's trying to find the girl. He goes to the roller rink, or there was some abandoned building, and they start talking in that building, and it's just, I couldn't even follow it, because I'm like, this movie is a disaster. I couldn't even stand to watch this thing. It's just, what's the point?
Wow.
Oh, wait.
What's the point?
The way that it's edited, and sometimes, and the way that it tries to be really, really flashy, It kind of takes away from the experience a little bit, I think, is what you're saying.
The transitions. If you notice the transitions, they go from the blinds, you know, the black blinds, it goes like, doot, 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 doot. It was like, what the fuck is going on? It's just like, it's very distracting. I don't know, I had to, like, just, like, try to watch it, but I kind of skipped around a bit. It's like, because there's one point where Sonny's hanging up artwork by the record company, and then Gene Kelly pops out and is like, hey, it's been a while. Let's hang out at my place, you know, listening to this record. And, you know, then you hear about his, Gene Kelly's character and how he was a singer in the past, you know, blah, 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 blah. And there's this one sequence where it's so weird, but it's like they're listening to the record, and you see this cross-faded moment where you see Gene Kelly, like, listening to it, but in the background you see, like, the 40s kind of sound, you know, performance from Olivia Newton-John performing the song.
It's a big band.
The big band playing. Oh, yeah. I was like, what is going on? What is going on? I don't know. I don't know anymore. But then all of a sudden he starts tap dancing with Olivia Newton-John. There's a tap dancing scene, and it was all choreographed by Gene Kelly, of course. Fun fact for you. It just goes nowhere with it.
Oh, I did notice. I did notice, too, that Kenny Ortega apparently took some choreographing as well.
Kenny Ortega did the choreography on this.
Yeah.
If it is of interest, they pretty much shot the movie when they were still writing the script.
Yes, and that was like the whole disaster. Because the production was those like all over the place.
Oh yeah.
Not to mention the reason they have that animated sequence, which of course you'll get into, was very last minute because they were like, oh, we have an additional song. We got to put this in the movie. How are we going to do this? I don't know. How are we going to do this? I don't know. Let's make an animated sequence so that way it'd be easier so we don't have to like reshoot extra material or something.
Thank you. That's the fun fact of that animation sequence in that movie. That's the only reason why they did that. But, yeah.
Because that's like the best scene in.
Sorry. One of the best scenes in the movie.
But okay, so so they start, you know, I guess Sonny and Lee Minun Jones starting to romance, you know, hang out, talk, blah blah blah. Gene Kelly has this idea to open up a club, you know, using that abandoned building, and there's this weird scene where they're trying to imagine what the club will look like, and Sonny's like, you know what, I can imagine a rock band over there in the corner. It's 1980s. And then Gene Kelly's like, you know, we're going to have a swinging big band over here, you know. And then all of a sudden, you see these two merge together. It's like 80s versus the 40s, and I'm thinking, what the hell? What is this?
I love that scene, okay? I want to say this. I gotta say, I'd love that because it was like, okay, the best of both worlds here just sort of mashing up together.
I know, it was like fantastic. I'm like, oh my god.
That was amazing.
My mind was blown. I was like, is this really happening? Is this really happening right now? So, of course, like I said, Sonny and Olivia Newton-John are romancing, and then, of course, it's a musical. You know, you gotta have Olivia Newton-John songs in there with ELO, and there's that song that pops up, and the animation sequence pops up, and you see the animation sequence by Don Bluth, you know. It's kind of like a circle of pattern thing where it turns from a fish to the bird and blah, 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 all lovey-dovey kind of
random
thing.
Random transformations, psychedelic scene.
Yeah, it was it's just like a mini animated music video, more or less.
Oddly enough, this that music video, because of Don Bluth's involvement with it, he actually there was a band a couple years ago called the Scissor Sisters. They remembered this sequence from Xanadu that he animated, and they got him to come in and do a music video for them.
Yeah, I saw that. That was pretty cool. And then right after that, it just goes, you know, I sort of like kind of wandered off after that because I was just like, at this point, I really don't care. Like, I've seen the Don Bluth animation sequence, like. It goes, like, Olivia Newton-John's character has to leave at one point because I think they're, like, Greek goddesses or something, because at one point, you know, Sonny tries to look for it again, I guess she vanishes, and he runs into that wall, goes into that portal, and all of a sudden he's talking to like, Zeus, and I'm just like...
At what point did he stop and say, you know what, I recognize that girl on the mural, I think I'll go roller skate into the wall.
If it worked for Aha, then it'll work for him.
Take on.
Yeah, it's just you know, he falls in love with this chick, and he's like, I want her. I want her so bad. You know, and eventually the club does open up, and it goes, and then once you see the club, you know, it's called Xanadu. But you see this cycle of Olivia Newton-John doing various genres. Like, it's, she goes from this genre to this genre. It's like, it's country at one point, and it's just like, and it's like, what? What are you doing? Just stop.
Yeehaw, Xanadu.
It's just so weird. And then, of course, she vanishes, and Sonny's like, where'd she go? And then all of a sudden, he turns, and the waitress, serving him a drink, looks just like her, and I'm like, oh, ho, 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 now you can fall in love with her all over again.
Oh, it's a very, yeah, this is a very sort of, this movie, I remember they were just desperately trying to save it after a while, because, you know, they wanted to say, okay, what's popular? Olivia Newton-John. We got her after Grease. Everyone wants to see more of her, so she's going to build this thing. We got ELO on board. We got roller skating, which is really popular right now. And it's like they started with this as an idea, this mesh of ideas here. And they, as some executive just said, make it happen. And they handed it over to somebody who, I don't know who directed this, but who wrote it, but they ended up coming up with something that was just like really flashy, but no substance. And it was kind of annoying. It was a hard to follow plot, like you said, Mike.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I agree. Like,
I love the music. I love the music for this movie. This is great.
Best part of it.
Oh yeah, definitely. The music was fantastic.
And I'm surprised to hear that Don's contribution was last minute, because, like I already said, that was my favorite moment in the film.
Yeah. What I think is interesting about Xanadu, because I like to watch a lot of romantic comedies. And romantic comedies are known for stupid plots, really cliched moments, and, well, this kind of is a romantic comedy. Mm-hmm. A really badly written romantic comedy, but that's what it is. It's like a romantic comedy musical, tries to be a musical, tries to be mindfucky. The movie doesn't know what it wants to be, so it just tries to do multiple things at once, which really fails. But in a weird way for me, I like it because it's weird. Maybe it's just because it tries to do so many things, and yes, the plot is very hard to follow. I'm amazed I followed along with the plot as well as I did. But I remember the last, like, 10 minutes when it got to Olivia Newton-John's character going all music video towards the end. I was like, what the hell? What does this have anything to do with the plot? So I finally just was texting Matt. I'm like, Matt, you're helping me now.
If it is of interest, the director who did Xanadu later did a whole long list of documentaries. Most notable were Outfoxed, War and Journalism, bless you, and bless Walmart, you. The High Cost of Low Price.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I don't know.
He's done other feature films, too.
Probably.
Oh, he has?
Yeah, his most notable stuff is in documentaries, but I was just looking at it. His name is Robert Greenwald.
Okay.
He's done The Burning Bed, Shattered Spirits, Sweetheart's Dance, Hear No Evil, Breaking Up, and lastly, Steal This Movie.
No, thank you.
No.
Already did.
Okay, go ahead, James.
Yeah, I was just gonna say, I don't think I'd. How do you put Xanadu and Outfoxed in the same category?
I
don't know. I just thought that'd be an interesting stare to just at least acknowledge that at least. I mean, it's just Xanadu is a really weird and screwed up movie to begin with, and it's like you put in Don Bluth's like, oh, I'm gonna do like a little demo reel and put that, you know, my animation there, yeah. And then people are gonna be like, oh.
Yeah, it's like something to, like, he thought it, like this is more something that he could fill his portfolio more so than something to enhance the scene.
Yeah, I'm gonna agree because the movie itself is very, like, very bad as far as, like, quality is concerned. But, yeah, the scene, that animation sequence alone is fantastic. Like, I loved watching all the transitions of the fish to birds to them becoming, like, more fairy-like. I thought that was brilliant. It was beautifully animated. And...
Mm-hmm.
And it was great that Don Bluth had a film that he could put his name on, even if it was just a really, if it was just part of the name of the portfolio. Good for you. It sucks, but you know what? It's enjoyably stupid, at least in my mind. Maybe it's just because it is a romantic comedy in a nutshell. It really is. It's a mindfuck romantic comedy musical. That's what
oh.
it is. That's exactly
oh, here's...
what it is.
Oh, and here's another fun fact about Xanadu. Apparently the failure of this the financial failure of this film, along with the Village People's Can't Stop the Music, were both inspirations for the Razzie Awards to begin.
Oh
wow, so that, wow, Xanadu is actually that bad?
Wow.
Apparently so, yes. And that's...
It's that kind of bad.
Wow, yeah, wow. I don't understand why. I really can, like, if you're looking for a plot, it's so hard to follow, it's like tape, really thin tape, you can just break it in the only things that are good about it are Don's sequence, and the music, and mm-hmm. the cast, and I like and Olivia Newton-John,
yeah,
and Gene Kelly.
Yeah, that was a nice number that they did there. Whenever you're away from me,
yes.
Wherever you go,
yeah,
yes, like, that was beautifully shot. I liked that scene where they were doing the whole dance number and everything. Yeah, I loved that. That was great.
Yeah, but this is the. This should have been at the point like, wait a minute, that girl that I knew in the past, why does she look like Michael Beck's girlfriend?
I love how that is true. It's only sort of brought up, but it just goes away within, like, tape.
Yeah,
within seconds.
It is so confusing. It's just like that. The very thin line, because they both know her from, you know, either... It's just...
It's amusing. I think it's amusing.
It's an 80s movie for crying out loud. I love those kind of musicals. Come on, I like the music. ELO is the best of the fucking world. I mean, Olivia Newton-John's not that bad. It's just...
Oh, I love Olivia Newton-John.
It's just...
Not that bad.
It's not that bad. I mean, I could just listen to the soundtrack instead of watching the movie. I mean, if you just want to see the Don Bluth animation sequence, just go on YouTube and somebody probably uploaded it already. You know, you can just watch that over and over and over without any context of the fucking movie.
You really
oh,
don't
and it's on
podcast.
Blu-ray, so you can watch it on you can watch it in HD now.
HD. Yeah, it's and it's funny because Michael Beck, who previously the year before was in the Warriors, which jump started his career, and Xanadu just you never see Michael
That's
Beck
funny.
Ever again.
That's
the Warriors true. Never came out to play after that.
Nope.
Ooh.
Yeah.
You know what? Though you know what's something that's kind of sad about the Don Bluth sequence. Not the fact it has no point. Like literally, I bet. Yeah. Like Mike was saying, you could put it on YouTube. You don't even need to have context. You can just say a Don Bluth's animated sequence from a weird as fuck 80s movie. Let's see
video.
How many people.
It's a music video. It's a basic music video. That's all it is. You know, you put it on YouTube.
It's like all these weird shapes and colors. It's like a music video.
Yeah.
You're doing a music video. Oh, okay. We're putting it in a movie. What?
Oh, God. No. No, I just thought how awesome that would have been. How awesome that would have been if instead of White Zombie, it would have been Don Bluth doing that desert sequence in Beavis and Butt-Head to America. like all that Twisted Nightmare stuff and like the demon dog from like All Dogs Go to Heaven after them.
Oh.
Hey, Beavis, what are you doing? What? Whoa.
Either that or it would suddenly become like that, that scene in that moment in that multiverse episode in Family Guy where suddenly they go into the Disney universe.
Yes! Look how gaily we run. Great sequence.
Mm-hmm. And I'd like to mention that up next, Matt teased it a bit. He's got it on DVD.
Yep.
And he's going to talk about The Secret of Nim.
Yes, I am going to get into The Secret of Nim, Don Bluth's first animated feature, and argued by many to be his magnum opus. And I just rewatched it today, and my God, it truly is a beautiful masterpiece. It really is. So basically, at first glance, it seems like your common animal, like your talking animal movie, where we see a bunch where we see a mouse going on an adventure and stuff like that. But no, this is real stuff. This gets pretty serious.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, where do I begin? Well, what I think really succeeds in The Secret of Nim is probably creating the world that it's in, where it's set in any ordinary world like ours. Like, it could be set in the real world, but it has such of this fantasy element into it. But I believe that it's so credible. Like, it's probably the most believable fantasy film I've seen, because it explains so well of the origins of the Rats of Nim, how it came to be, how they pretty much evolved into these sentient beings, how they pretty much grew intelligent, how they took, how they managed to make electricity, how they got clothing and all that kind of stuff, how they pretty much turned intelligent. It was this brilliant idea, the construction of it, the world it's set in, it's just phenomenal. Even when there is magic, it's like they've grown so advanced to the point that now they've gone into elements that even science could not even explain. That's amazing. But also there are the characters as well that really do make this movie so enjoyable. Well, number one, we got Mrs. Brisby, who is a very rare breed, who is a main character and is also a mother. Normally in animated films, those die so easily, but no. She is actually a widow whose husband passed away, and she is doing all this because... holy crap, Morgan, by the way, what the fridge is going on with you? Or am I the only one seeing that?
What things are normal on my end?
Everything looks good to me.
Are you sure? I don't know. I'm seeing weird things going on with your cam, but anyways, sorry. Yeah, anyways, going back into Mrs. Brisby, she's pretty much a you can tell that she is a devoted mother, because she's doing it all for her sick son, Timmy, who has pneumonia. So she's really going out of her way in order to go and try to save her son, because at the same time, it was moving day, because the farmer was about to start his plow, and all the animals got to get the fridge out of there, or else they're going to be entirely killed. So she is going she's going the long way in order to save her family, to actually go and meet the great owl. That is honestly one of the highlighted scenes, because it truly emphasizes the elements of suspense in this film. She also has to go and meet up with the Rats of Nim, this secret organization, and they all agree to go and move her house entirely, to move it from one place to another. And she does all these things in order to save her son and eventually her entire family, along with this organization that her deceased husband used to be in. And like I said, the suspense is really there, but this is also a really intense movie. This is not necessarily funny, but it truly is intense. They get into, like, the action scenes. My God, you really get into them. Rather it be Mrs. Brisby running away from Dragon, or when you see a fight, like, when you see the sword fight scene at the end, it really is epic. Like,
Dragon's a cat, by the way, guys.
Yeah, Dragon is a cat. Yeah, every element, like, it truly captures this element of suspense, of mystery, regarding, like, this organization called the Rats of Nim, and, like, the intensity, how serious these situations can be, and what's really at stake. They really got it down. And I think the only bit of criticism that I would have is probably that maybe the characters could have been fleshed out more. Jenner, I would say, is a fantastic villain. But I feel like he would probably need a bit more scenes because, I don't know, I feel like he should have been in a few more scenes to flesh out. I feel like he's a bit rushed, like, to have the elements like, okay, here's the plan, I'm going to do it, now let's go, oh no, I'm going to be screwed up, have a fight, and all that kind of stuff. And then there's also Jeremy, who can argue, like, I wouldn't blame people if they say that Jeremy feels a bit annoying. But at the same time, I do feel like Don Bluth kind of made him that way, where, like, because, like, there are several scenes where even Mrs. Brisby felt annoyed by him. So, like, he would go, like, she would find all these different ways to, like, you know, to make him scram off. And, but at the same time, I don't, like, he's not necessarily a bad character. Like, he does have his own goals and stuff like that. You know, he wants to find a maid. He wants to try to go and impress a girl. So, like, he's trying to find out all these ideas. And, you know, he does feel like Mrs. Brisby is someone he can count on, like, as a friend. So, you know, he's just someone, you know, who wants to help, like, yeah, he's clumsy, he's not that bright, but he just wants to help out, and all he wants is a girlfriend. So, that like, I don't necessarily blame the guy. It's like, he feels annoying, but at the same time, I can't really hate him. But other than that, this is just purely beautiful. And plus, I think there's nobody who's going to deny the animation here is freaking phenomenal. It really is. I mean, keep in mind, this was back in the day when Disney is pretty much going into the Xerox process, and it was one of the reasons why Don Bluth kind of quit the studio, because the animation wasn't like the good old days when they would use pure handmade animation cells. And the Xerox process, it doesn't look as nice. Like, when you look at something like Sword in the Stone or 101 Dalmatians, the animation kind of looks kind of crude, and like the drawings look a bit rough compared to how the, like, when they're on the color. So it doesn't look as great as they previously were. So that's why he wanted to go back with the old-fashioned way with the Secret of Nim. And every element is just beautiful. This, like, the hand draw, like, the character animation is masterclass. I gotta have a mention about the effects, because those are freaking beautiful. Rather mm-hmm. it be, like, using the magic, using, like, the elements, like water, fire, and water, electricity, and all that kind of stuff. Everything about, like, backgrounds are also really gorgeous as well. Just everything about it is just so beautiful. And honestly, Secret of Nim is just hands. I don't know how else to say it, but it's a godforsaken masterpiece. It's just so beautiful. And, you know, I'm pretty glad to say that I don't know if I could consider it underrated anymore, because thanks to the internet, it's going pretty much in the same route as The Iron Giant, in a sense. It's not fully up there, but it has start to gain like more and more of a following, and it's starting to become way up there, getting into the ranks of an animated masterpiece. Like, a lot more people are seeing it and are recognizing it, and, you know, honestly, I think I could take it off the list as an underrated film, because people are noticing it.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know anybody who hasn't seen The Secret of Nim, so I don't...
I haven't.
Or hasn't heard of it.
I was going to say...
Hasn't heard of it, I should say.
There's actually a pretty funny story behind this movie. I remember seeing this before reading the book, and I was surprised to see how the two differed so greatly. And in fifth grade, we had this whole thing where there'd be a certain book title picked out, and we'd have to find and figure out exactly what the book was. And upon finding it, someone had to read it, show proof that they read it, and they get like a small prize, like a candy bar or something. And I remember the teacher, the first hint that he gave us to the secret book was, in fact, you know, something about rodents. So we thought, okay, maybe it's the mouse and the motorcycle. Then a few weeks later, we couldn't figure out what it was, and so he gave the second hint, and he played frisbee with someone. Everyone in the class got the title. And so after that, we raced. No, we didn't just walk. We raced to the library in the school, and we were scattering around trying to find a copy of it. And I'm just standing there going, I got one on my bookshelf. What the hell am I doing here? But no, it's a very nice start to Don Bluth's career. It's sort of his Wizard of Oz, per se. I do say it's a very well-made movie. It's very beautifully done. I'm still trying to pinpoint exactly why I'm not so harping on it too much. I do regard it as a masterpiece. I really do. I think it's a very beautifully done movie. Maybe it's the side characters or the fact the story feels a little too rushed at times.
Like I said, if it's something like Jeremy or something like that, I don't blame you.
Well, yeah, Jeremy's okay, except when he's, you know, being tied up by kids being mistaken as a turkey. I mean, those bits I liked very much. That's a turkey! Those bits kind of slow the movie down a little bit, but you gotta have at least some comic relief.
Yeah. Jeremy needs to find a mate who's into BDSM.
Accidental BDSM.
Now I shall now read for you on tonight's program, 50 Shades of Feathers. Oh yay, said Jeremy, I believe that is my wishbone growing, as a ball of yarn dropped down from yay hiney.
Oh no, it was a telescope.
That's another story for another day. But no, I do regard it. It's a great film. The voice acting is good. There's some really good intense spots. The ideology of the rats and having this cognitive thinking and seeing whether they should be, you know, seeing things as, you know, good and evil, that's always interesting. Those are nice themes that will never go over kids' head and that never talks down to them. The final sword scene, there are a couple bits I do like to nitpick there. How in the world did Justin figure out it was Jenner the whole time? That was just on a fly. He was like, it was you. How? What was the clue?
Like I said, I feel like the villain, like, in terms of Jenner, they didn't look at him as much, so we didn't have time. You know, honestly, that could be one of the biggest problems with the movie, is that they didn't look into the Rats of Nim that much. I understand that we're seeing it all in the perspective of Mrs. Brisby, but... like, you got this entire world. Like, they looked upon it very, very well, but not too much, but not enough to the point that we fully understand what's going on their side. Like, they did hint out that Jenner is usually the troublemaker, but like, I don't know. I guess it's kind of like a random line that just picks out. It's like, it was you. It's like, why?
I will say, though, I do think the film and the book are kind of equals, in my opinion, but there's always one thing that really bugged me that they left out, and I'm going to spoil a little bit here. In the novel, the rats, when they escape, they come across a dead toy tinker and this van of stuff, and that's how you learn how they got the technology to build this whole little city under this rose bush. And I always thought that was interesting, because it's like, okay, now we know where they got these items, where they were able to craft these kind of things just from this rundown truck. I felt that was a detail they kind of cut out, which could have helped things a little bit more than just randomly stealing electricity and everything. But you could argue they've been doing it for years in the farmers, which makes it even
they even said like it was it's been 5 years since they stole the electricity.
Here's one of my biggest nitpicks of the film.
Was this when we were rewatching it and we kind of figured that Miss Brisby's husband was slightly younger than she was?
Yes.
Wasn't that one? I guess because I know we had a little bit of an issue with that one.
Or are you kind of talking about like when we saw when we actually see Jonathan Brisby?
Kind of, sorta. But here's my issue. She has to go out and about and learn all this stuff about how Jonathan Brisby, her husband, her late husband, helped the rats escape from them, and how at some point it has to be explained to her by Nicodemus that he would have aged a lot slower. Yes, he ages a lot slower. And I'm just sort of thinking after that, I said, Mrs. Brisby, how well did you know your husband before you married him? Think about this. You don't think this is something that they brought up like on the honeymoon? Like, honey, there's something I need to bring up. If I start, don't age very visibly in the next coming months, don't be surprised.
By the way, if
you want something more naturalistic, go for poppy and rye.
Or actually, on that account, Mrs. Brisby should have asked us, like, Jonathan, where do you learn how to read?
It is true. It's funny how she's just sort of accepts what her husband says and doesn't question him. Mm-hmm. And yet it's so interesting how independent her character is in the film. Like how she learns to eventually, this is like her journey. She's literally starting out as a scared mother who just wants to save her children, save her family from the plow. Then towards the end of the film, where she's able to grab that jewel and be able to help save the day. I mean, I guess maybe that's intentional, I don't know, to make her not as strong and not as independent at first. I'm sorry, but just point that out. But maybe towards later in the film, that's when she develops her true character, where she realizes she can be independent. She can take care of herself.
Keep in mind, though, that she was a widow.
Well, yeah,
and,
I know.
Like, it's been, like, and she's still trying to recuperate.
Yeah.
So she still needed a bit of time in order to, you know, to make herself a bit more independent, to take care of everything herself.
Yeah. Yeah, I get that. I mean, that's kind of my point, yeah, because, first, I have to say yes, I've read both the book and seen the film.
Okay.
So, yeah. Okay.
Out of curiosity, Devin, what do you prefer, the climax of the book or the climax of the movies? I'm trying not to spoil too much.
I don't remember the climax.
The climax of the book had the scientists from NIMH going in and destroying the rosebush, and a good bulk of the rats were able to escape or something to that extent. In the movie, it's more like, no, they're coming, they have this big tussle between like science technology, and then Brisby saves the house and it's all good, and the NIMH people come in and they're like, oh, we don't see any rats, we'll just go and wait for the sequel or something.
You know, the funny thing is,
Dr. Valentine, fetch!
Oh, God. Don't even get me started with that thing. I recently saw the sequel. And I will admit that it's not as bad as, like, you'd think it is. Like, a lot of people would say it's one of the worst animated films. Far from it, actually. It's more of your standard bad, but other than that, holy crap. It's just... Look, Eric Idle, though. Freaking Eric Idle.
Eric Idle saves everything, but... Oh, well, I will admit this. Like, when I read the book, I was very surprised. Maybe it's just because, I actually saw the film and then read the book. Because I didn't even know it was based off of a book. Thank you, Matt, for your look back, because that was my introduction to Don Bluth. But, the funny thing is, when I read the book, I was very surprised, like, how different the endings were. I just remember, I was like, if I had to choose, like, probably the one that makes more sense is the book, but the more memorable one is the film. And I think it's more memorable in the film when she's trying to grab the jewel and she has to grab it and it's burning her. Even it's a little bit burning her, and she has to grab it in order to help save the day. So if I had to go with just which one I prefer, like what I'll remember the most, I'm definitely going with the film. I mean, I can sort of understand why they changed it, but
there is a lot more drama going on in the movie, which clearly ups what happens in the original novel.
Yeah, isn't it the entry.
Is it ironic at all that I'm the only one here, aside from Mike, maybe, that has not read the book?
I have yet to read the book, actually.
Well, okay.
Matt, I'm not surprised at you, but James.
I know. I'm the book to movie guy.
Yeah, see, failure. Matt, I'm not calling you a failure because I was expecting it.
How many pages are there in Rats and Nim?
A good bulk. A good, decent bulk. They do retain a couple of things here and there. I'm trying to read the big differences. I know for a fact Frisbee in the novel doesn't escape by herself from the cage. I know that much. I'm trying to go too far. Like I said, the ending is definitely different.
No, I'm not saying the difference is how many. I'm just saying how many pages.
Oh, it's like 233. I actually have the book on me, so it's like 200.
Right. If I can find an audiobook, it'll be a good thing to use for the gym.
Oh yeah.
I do know that Jenner's not the villain in the book.
In the next one, they do make a reference to him, like, oh, he's supposed to be the villain. Like, the son of Jenner's all like, please don't prosecute me because I am part of an anteater or something.
He is part anteater?
Anti-hero.
Oh, anti-hero. Oh, I heard part anteater.
You know what? I think I'll warm up for this one by grabbing the nearest mouse-related dark novel that I can get a. Hold on, hang on a second. Yeah. Okay.
Damn it.
Yeah. Okay, I'm ready now.
I love that book.
Is it terrible to say that fudge nabbit. Hold on. Let me redo that. Is it terrible? Is it terrible for me to say that mouse gives me gas?
Oh. Oh. You are. I am.
Yeah. The answer is yes. Apparently.
Asshole.
I mean that is evil right there. Like, wow.
Yeah, you asshole. You know, I want.
Is it really that bad? Is the joke really that awful?
Yeah. If you grab the book, yes it is.
This is about freaking Auschwitz.
Don't you mean Mauschwitz?
Actually, you know, you're right. It should be Mauschwitz, because that's what they say in the book.
That is pretty funny, actually. Yeah, very true. Oh my god.
Okay.
Philip Mauschwitz.
Adolf Mauschwitz. Okay, Mike, where have you gone?
Zeke Feivel.
So from The Secret of Nim, we're going to hop to the next movie, which is All Dogs Go to Heaven. Morgan, take it away.
Wow, I thought James had Land Before Time or American Tale. This is kind of awkward.
We've talked about Land Before Time in the past. That is my favorite one. That is my favorite Don Bluth film. Oddly enough, it's one of the few that's going to be talked about here that from the 80s that doesn't have Dom DeLuise. But
I was at a bit of a choosing here. I had either my favorite Don Bluth movie, which of course is Land Before Time, over All Dogs Go to Heaven, but I haven't seen All Dogs Go to Heaven in a long time, so I figured, you know, I might as well revisit, see if it holds up. Again, I always have that fear where it's like, if something doesn't, if I haven't seen in a long time, and if it doesn't hold up as well as I thought, it's that instance where it's like, oh, brother, how did I survive through this one as a kid? Which, of course, counts for a good bulk of Lamb 4 Time sequels. Anyway,
you just went all batshit on those sequels.
We should have finished them off years ago.
I was okay with the second and third. When they got to four and fifth, that's when I started going, forget it. But no, All Dogs Go to Heaven, that was another one I watched quite a lot as a kid. And it was because it was, you know, a straightforward dog story, at least in my opinion. But now that I'm older and seeing it for what it is, it was a much different viewing experience. And you're following this character who's not necessarily a good guy. He's not actually, you know, perfect. You have Charlie Marker, voiced by Burt Reynolds, who's pretty much a fugitive escaping from the city pound, in a pretty humorous joke, you know, playing up the dog pounds like a giant jail cell. And he sort of, you know, tries to get back with his old gambling roots, but unfortunately his partner Carface won't allow it and has him bumped off. Charlie goes to heaven, realizes he's been screwed, and finds, in a metaphorical aspect, that literally a watch symbolizing his own life, which is a little clever MacGuffin, has stopped, and the only way to get back to Earth is to rewind that watch and go back. There's a couple of problems with that, but I'll get to them later. Technically speaking, but later. No. So he goes back to Earth and decides he uses this means of resurrection as a way to get revenge back on Carface. And this is where it gets fairly interesting, but at the same time, it raises a couple of questions. First off, he plans to build a bigger casino. Okay, fine. How to do so, he discovers that Carface has kept underground a little girl voiced by Judith Brassey, who apparently has the will to talk to animals.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, she's an orphan. Number two, she's one of those super orphans that has a special ability that, for some weird reason, Don Bluth decided to make her look like Snow White.
Super orphan!
Hey, I've always wanted to see Snow White with badass powers.
They don't explain why she has these talking animal powers, but it's a fantasy. Okay, I can let that slide by. Poor Mike, he's coughing.
Mm-hmm.
Mike, don't forget to wind your watch. I just want to say right now, don't forget to wind your watch. You'll be okay.
Or you can wind up your beanie cap, whatever works.
So pretty much this whole movie is sort of like a trial of Charlie's, side in general, because you have this little pretending to your conscience, you know, gambling is bad and all that sort of stuff, and sort of harping on exactly what kind of person he is. And that's actually pretty interesting. A lot of people often view this kind of movie as sort of like, good guy has this, bad guy has this change of heart later on in the film. We kind of warm up to him and everything. That is more suited for Despicable Me. I think this one, watching it again as an adult, it really looks in quintessentially this mobster and viewing him for what he really is, and then realizing exactly what he did with his life. And it's interesting too, because this is mirrored in two big scenes, one where he's up in heaven and the whippet like fairy angel is looking through the book and she's like, oh, let's see what good deeds you have here. Oh, I don't see anything in here, but I guess you're okay to go to heaven because all dogs go to heaven.
Yeah. There's I wonder, you know, like, just on that alone, heaven has some really weird red tape. It's like, okay, so all dogs go to heaven, but human beings, we kind of have to prove ourselves somehow.
So
it's going to be a flip of a coin.
Yeah.
So all right, Hitler, you're in.
So for the most part, when I'm watching this movie, I'm sort of just, you know, James is there. I was sitting there. I was like, okay, the songs are kind of decent. Okay, this whole journey thing is interesting. The point that really made me realize what this movie was about was later on near the end when he's at a church. He has, you know, a girlfriend there or something. All these different pups. It's assumed he's possibly the father or not.
Fan theories. Hit the comment section right now.
I say adultery on the collie.
That's just a film theory.
Mm-hmm. Moving on. He's in this church. He has the girl, you know, getting sick after a big-lipped alligator moment, which we'll get into in a moment. And there's this scene where his, you know, partner Itchy, played by Dom DeLuise, comes back to them injured and everything because he car-faced destroyed their casino, and he goes on about how he's becoming soft and everything. Oh, no, actually, before that, there's a bit where he mentions about how this whole idea of getting revenge was wrong and everything, and that is really sort of the big thesis of the movie. You have this mobster character that all he knows about is tricks, roots, and dirty deeds. And here he is using these means when he has this second chance at life, which he pretty much forcibly did. And now it finally dawns on him that all this time, this was not the way to be when he had these different, you know, options and ways of, you know, possibly improving his life. There's that scene where he feeds a little pup's pizza and either sees as, you know, something to show Anne-Marie that he's supposedly a good person or, you know, just because he hasn't seen this person in a long time. But then when we get to this, like, this whole church scene, we finally get to the main meat of exactly what kind of character Charlie is. And it's done so ambiguously that, you know, even I told James that I could just analyze this one scene for like a good 5 to 10 minutes. Mm-hmm. You know, Itchy is harping on him, like, you know, you've become a softy, you know, this person all because of this girl. And then he lashes out saying that the girl was only just part of a pawn in his plan to get back at Carface. She's there on the steps listening to all this. She gets heartbroken, runs out, and this could be seen in two different ways. Number one, they're in a church. Mm-hmm. And what do people do when they go to a church? Confess their sins. So, in a logical sense, we're either seeing Charlie for what he truly is, or he's literally just stating exactly this whole giant scheme he had, which he's finally realizing it was a bad idea.
Either way, it's a type of confession.
Exactly.
And
the other thing, too, which some people have pointed out, that he's just saying all these, you know, lies to Charlie when he's actually going to do, you know, good for her. Personally, if I had to be honest, I'm kind of sticking to the first theory a little more, because it really does make sense for the character arc that Charlie goes through. Mm-hmm. So at the end, when he's going to save Anne-Marie, he's finally, you know, realizing that there's more important life than her because of how much he's lived through, which, you know, gives him all the more reason why he goes to heaven in the end. It's a very deep movie, and it makes me wonder, how come I didn't watch this too much of my time? I mean, Land Before Time, don't get me wrong, I still think that's a beautiful movie for the hour we spend, the little journey with the dinosaurs going through and playing off each other. Mm-hmm. With All Dogs Go to Heaven, there's a lot more going on than I ever depicted. You have this bad guy that's going through all these different temptations and these different trials, and at the end he sort of realizes, yeah, he could have made a difference, and at least he did at the very last minute, showing that he does have at least some resentment from humanity. Now, is it a perfect movie? Not 1%. There are a couple of things I do have problems with. The character Carface, I actually kind of find him interesting. Like, all the credit to Don Bluth and Vic, what's his name, who voices him.
The guy from, what was it? Charles, isn't it Charles?
Not Charles Nelson Reilly. Charles Nelson Reilly is Killer, the accomplice. I guess I try to make him, like, you know, mean.
Ed Asner, you're thinking, no?
No, it's not Ed Asner. They try to make him like this big menace sort of character, but it never really stuck out to me that much. He always, you know, kind of feel like he had like this really weird kind of growling kind of menace, and then the only times it kind of got interesting but yet weird when he had like these big expressions, like I think there's this scene where whatever we're near the end, he starts, his head gets like bigger and bigger when Charlie gets the upper hand or something like that, or the bit where he has like the laser gun or something, and you see like his mouth gets like bigger and wider. It's really weird.
I am a Flash Gordon ray gun boss.
A ray gun. Yeah, there's stuff like that that gets a little strange. Like, number one, how did he find out that Charlie's alive? That just felt really strange. Like, just out of nowhere, we cut to him. Charlie's alive. You lied to me, killer.
Yeah, that is amusing, actually. I thought about that myself when I was watching the film, and I was like, I don't know, how did he figure it out?
But of course, the focus is on Charlie, so all more to him. Which is funny as a kid, because I found myself more connected to the Itchy character more than Charlie. I don't know, maybe it's because of Dom DeLuise's voice, so the character was fun, but either way. There's a lot of comedic chemistry between Bert and Dom, which is actually pretty interesting. No surprise, too, seeing you know, the Cannonball films supposedly did a lot of ad-libbing in the recording booth, so it's no wonder how they got along so well during this film. So there's a lot of great scenes between the two, like one where Dom's character Itchy passes the idea of setting up the casino in the Himalayas.
Mm-hmm.
Which is actually pretty humorous. But there's like a central core to these two. They're both friends, even though they both kind of... And I don't want to say backstab, that's actually not a good term. Sort of... you can tell they're distant, but they still kind of, you know, hook on to each other because they're partners, which all comes full circle near the end, again, at that church scene. Mm-hmm. The musical numbers are decent. Nothing really too standout-ish aside from one or two songs, especially one that Judith's character, Anne Marie, sings, Soon You Come Home. Let's talk about the alligator in the room. history lesson, people. There's a scene in the movie, don't worry, Matt, we're not getting to that just yet.
Oh, okay.
It's okay, we can take a breather. You gotta go through the comedy in order to get through the dark. There's a scene in the movie where they come across an alligator that eats people, and in fear, Charlie howls like an opera singer, you know, after nearly getting munched on. And then the alligator realizes...
He has vibrato in his howl.
And then the gator realizes, oh, I can't eat something that has such a beautiful note. And then it goes into this bird-burskly water girl synchronized swimming sequence with the gator and Charlie as they sing, let's make music together. And it's at this point I'm realizing Burt Reynolds is having a moment with Oogie Boogie.
That is true.
Let's make sweet harmony. Oh, let's make music together.
Is it guilty for me to say if they do an animated version of Rocky Horror Picture Show, they should have him play Frankenfurter? Really think about that. Really think about that. He still has the soul and voice.
Yeah, Ken Page.
Yeah, I mean, every year he still sings the Oogie Boogie song, so...
So, of course, in internet years later, thanks to Lindsay Ellis, a.k.a. the Nostalgia Chick, who's semi-retired, supposedly.
Well, she's still doing videos, but not as... She retired the Nostalgia Chick.
Oh, cool. So, because of the randomness of the sequence that comes out of nowhere and no one makes a reference to the scene, not the character, just the way the scene plays out, it's been dubbed in history as a trope being the big-lipped alligator moment, being something that comes out of the blue in a movie, it happens, and then afterwards, nobody mentions it again. Though, to argue this, it's not the character this trope focuses on, it's the scene as a whole. Because, let's face it, it immediately goes from like this dark, gritty, primal, King Kong-like scenario with all the bones and everything, and then turns into a light, fluffy musical number. What the hell?
Because character progression, right? When you don't have much of a plot, you gotta jazz hands your way out of there.
Yeah. Another criticism I do have is the animation. There are times where it looks good, but there are times it looks a little off. There's this crowd sequence where they're searching around for, like, someone to panhandle and hustle, and you see, like, these upward shots of the human characters, and they look very bizarrely, what's the word we're looking for? Rotoscoped, I think is the term, rotoscoped?
Yeah.
There are times that they do that, it looks really weird. There's this bizarre stretch and squash on some of the horses, which looks a little strange. I guess I want to make them a little cartoony or something. It's a minor nitpick, but I can kind of be okay with that. The rest of the animation, certain scenes are fine. It knows when to be bright and beautiful and gritty and, you know, dirty. So yeah, if one person is going to bring this up, I might as well, and I'm not going to go into the dark details, so don't worry. Mm-hmm. For those who don't know, the actress, Brassy?
Judith Barcy.
Terribly sorry, Judith Barcy played Anne-Marie, and sadly, this and Land Before Time was released post, ominously.
Mm-hmm.
I bring this up because at the end of the VHS tape, Prologues Go to Heaven, there's a PSA with Dom DeLuise. And in this PSA, he mentions about the Boys Club of America, I think it is, and its purpose and sponsorship. And for years, I always wondered why would they bring this up and add that little tag at the end. And then I found out why when I learned the reasons behind the tragic death of Judith. I'm not going to go into the deep details, but if you want the long, 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 long story short, father abuse is a very, very serious thing that's coming across these days. Any form of parental abuse is really awful. And so it is up there with a lot of taboo issues that will make someone so uncomfortable they will clench, not wince, not look dumbfounded, just clench. And after watching this kind of movie, it feels interesting but yet bittersweet to see Judith go through and do this movie despite the intensity of the character and what she goes through. For example, the scene we first see her, she begs the Carface to go outside, and Carface is like, I don't care, you talk to animals, that's your job. And here you have Charlie. Yeah, Charlie is doing the wrong. He's like, you know, using this character, but at least he's getting the best of both worlds. She's at least, you know, treating him and doing things for her and stuff like that. Even if it's the means just to, you know, use her to get revenge. And for the longest time, I never really noticed those ironic connections up until now. I know it wasn't meant to be, you know, in conjunction, but it seems to me that because of that one incident, moment in life that shook Hollywood and the world, that is a theory where I think things kind of changed a little. That's like the helicopter incident from the Twilight Zone movie. This is pretty much that incident in question. I think after that, that's when things started to change for the 90s, where we went to this more brightful, colorful kind of aspect, not just with the Disney Renaissance and everything, but it's just a little bit of a quizzing theory that there's always that one little event that kind of starts to change things just a tad. That's why I think we got Rockadoodle and all those other films, not just because they were meddled in the writing and the studio, but I think at that point, you kind of wonder, maybe it's good to go in this different direction and do something a little more lighter after something that problematic. I mean, hell, Steven Spielberg, when he was working on Twilight Zone, the movie after that helicopter incident, which I won't go too deep into either. Number one, if he continued with the original segment he was working on, which would involve Halloween costumes coming to life on kids, he probably wouldn't have had the chance to work with kids again. Hence why is the underwhelming kick the can segment. So I just want to throw this out there. I just want to say, for the most part, Something like this is definitely not to joke around with or mess with. It's not easy to talk about either.
Mm-hmm.
But in retrospect, it is one of those things that is not very good to look back upon, but at the same time, how well will we know from history if we don't know about these things? So mm-hmm. if you know someone that's going through a tough time or anything that much, you know, talk to them, please. But skipping all that aside, despite the fact that it was her final film, the performance itself is very nicely done, especially mm-hmm. that ending. My God, that ending, where, you know, her and Charlie see each other for the final time, it really does feel like that they're both in better places now. And mm-hmm. I think for me, it's ironic in that sense.
Although I will admit that the ending, I will say, considering with the context of what happened to Judith Barcy, with that in mind, it does feel tragically awkward at the same mm-hmm. time.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, I actually have thoughts on this. Like, I remember when I did find out about what happened to her and the abuse. Like, I felt so bad for her and what she had to go through. Not only was it her father, but I'm just going to mention this. The mom drives me nuts. I'm not going to reveal why, but it drove me nuts. Like, there's actually a YouTube video that does go into this. Like, they literally had interviews with the family members and what happened during that time, what caused the family to be like this. And I watched this and I was like, my God, what the hell? And it just blew my mind. Like, how did they go through this? And the ending to All Dogs definitely is one of those ironic, kind of very ironic endings. And I said it when I rewatched the movie again, I cried. I was crying at the end of the movie.
I got teary-eyed too last night.
Every time Morgan and I watch movies together, or any of us for that matter, we'll always be able to tell, okay, we crack riffs and whatnot at certain scenes and whatnot. Every scene with Anne Marie, pretty much, I was just shut up.
Yeah.
Because, like, you cannot say anything.
No.
I mean, it's just...
It was just
heartbreaking. Like, the moment that they have between there at the end, I'm like, I'm not going to say shit.
I mean, hell, even I still tear up too when I hear her say, Petrie, you're safe. Yep, 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 yep. It's like, oh.
I adore her voice, and it is very sad that she went through all that.
Yeah, honestly, I remember when I discovered it. It was when I got curious, like thinking back of all the Land Before Time sequels. It's like, whatever happened to all the original people? And when I found out about Judith Barcy, it's like a series of events that it's like it gets worse and worse the deeper you go into it. It's like, I was like, oh, what happened to the voice of Ducky? Oh God. Oh. Yeah, it's like that bad.
Yeah.
Yeah, I feel bad.
It's so bad to the point we can't even discuss it.
Mm-hmm.
It's horrible.
It's hard even for me. Like, I just remember getting angry and upset, like, watching it. Like, I wish I could reveal more, but it's just hard for me to do.
It's awful.
I went about as far as I could when I found out about it, and I was like, okay.
Yeah, but to at least bring a bright side back to this, there's an old saying Mel Brooks had, which is, if you're in a movie, you'll be remembered no matter if it's a small role or a big role. And I think in the case of Judith, I think she'll be well remembered regardless.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Oh, I agree.
I mean, where we all have a purpose, I believe that we all have a purpose that we're put on this earth to do something, and maybe that was her thing to, you know, she these last two movies that she worked on, she made an impact, mm-hmm. and that's going to be her legacy.
Yeah.
Right there.
That will be her legacy, I agree. I do want to bring something up about All Dogs, and this is not about her, but this is about Dom DeLuise. What I think is interesting is all these movies that Dom was in. He was in Secret Event. He was in this film. And it was pretty funny that the only one he wasn't in was Planet Before Time. And then when I discovered more research, I was like, oh, wait, he went to Disney. He did Oliver and Company. So they literally came out the same year. So that's what made it hilarious is freaking how they made it. But then I watched both movies, and yeah, both characters, have you realized they're really similar? Dom DeLuise seems to have this almost similar character he plays. The dim-witted, the sidekick.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, true.
Mm-hmm.
If you compare the two, they are very similar. They're very dim-witted, they're not very smart. Like, I will admit, Itchy is the smarter of the dim-witted. But that's not saying much, especially considering.
And the one thing, sorry, Morgan, I just need to add this one more thing, is that, like, it has yet to be mentioned, but I'm surprised that you didn't mention about the fact of how Don Bluth feels more free with All Dogs Go to Heaven, because keep in mind, this was his first movie that he went with, it's either Goldsmith or Goldberg?
Goldcrest.
He went with Gold. That it was the first time he finally went with Goldcrest, and he can go and make whatever movie he wants. And he was no longer under the chains of Steven Spielberg and George Lucas when he was working on An American Tale or The Land Before Time. So, it does bring out a more interesting transition to see like what is more like. I know that a lot of people would define a Don Bluth movie simply by the animation because, like, he does have this specific style. But in terms of, like, storytelling and stuff like that, it seems like an interesting transition. I wonder if any of you guys would notice any massive differences in terms of the storytelling when it comes to, like, when Don Bluth would move from something like An American Tale and The Land Before Time to All Dogs Go to Heaven.
There is a progression when you do think about it, because there are some points where it does get pretty dark in American Tale and Land Before Time, yet the difference is that with All Dogs Go to Heaven, it's a darker tale because it's talking about heaven and hell. Hell, the scene in hell is so beautifully done and horrifying at the same time. It's a surreal nightmare. It's the vision of hell we don't want. And that's what makes it so amazing. Here he is on this little boat, and this giant monster comes out of nowhere and breathes fire and everything. For what it is, it's obvious that he had more free reign with this movie. Though it does make me wonder what the original version was like, because in an interview, they had a much more complex version, and they pitched it to this one guy, and his reaction was, "Where's the men's room?" And then after 5 minutes, he came back and he said, "You got too many angels, you got too many of this, just stick to this and it'll be fine." It's always interesting to see how the progression of a story goes, so I'm a little curious how that went. But the even more ironic thing, too, it didn't do that well at the box office. I mean, okay, it was able to get its budget back, but not well enough to make, like, a huge splash or a staple when The Little Mermaid came by.
No, it's because of The Little Mermaid. It's all because of The Little Mermaid.
But here's the irony. Here's the big piece of irony. When it came out on home video, it was a sleeper hit selling out 3 million copies.
I believe it was, I think, one of, or if not, like, the highest-selling VHS of all time, I believe.
It was! It nearly topped the 50th anniversary of The Wizard of Oz. That's how big it was in the 1990s.
Nearly. The first night that me and my siblings rented this movie, we watched it twice the same night, back to back. I remember that. It was like, okay, this movie is that damn good. But in terms of the storytelling aspects, Matt, one thing that I was noticing while watching with Morgan last night is look back on every Don film that we've talked about thus far, excluding Xanadu. There's always a rather subtle spiritual aspect to it, and Don, being, you know, a Mormon, I think may have said I want to put this in the film with Secret of Nim. It's mostly dealing with the mystical, the unknown. Nothing actually religious is pointed out per se.
And it does, like, it actually goes more into the scientific aspect, oddly enough.
In An American Tale, you have they don't go into Judaism specifically, but it's
even that opening sequence where the Russian Jews get attacked, it feels like a little bit like an afterthought at times, or it's sort of like glanced over. If it's supposed to be like this big historical fantasy,
that was also the Spielberg touch, apparently, too.
Yeah, that's the thing. I wouldn't count that as a Don Bluth thing, because like the whole aspect of the Judaism and having Fievel as the name, that's all Spielberg.
Obviously.
And then we come to The Land Before Time, which is
for Christians.
Oh my goodness! It's about to break out from underneath. I mean, the Christ parallels, the journey to the West stuff.
Follow the
bright circle. It is God.
I felt so bad for Bluth during that movie, and this is true. He was left in the care of George Lucas because Steven Spielberg was busy with another movie at the time. I'm trying to remember which one. But anyway, they were with Lucas. Lucas really put the croquet mallet on that one. I think he was like behind the whole thing, you know, trying to lighten it up and everything. And then, of course, Spielberg came in and agreed to the whole 10-minute footage removal. So, in a sense, it was Lucas first, and then it went to Spielberg and was like, yeah, it's going to be darker.
And so you get to All Dogs Go to Heaven, and it's the spiritual aspects of this are completely unhinged. You're not just going to extremes with the whole Christian stuff, but also they're borrowing from Greek mythology and Chiron.
I mean,
especially with the hell scene. That,
yes,
like, you could definitely tell the different inspirations. Especially, like, I might have noticed a few of the Dante's Inferno, I believe, like.
Yeah.
Or no, that could be Greek, actually.
Yeah. And all throughout his work in the 90s, I didn't see anything spiritual.
No, not his later ones.
No. So it was
after
like...
After All Dogs.
This one was like a spiritual ejaculation for him, and then he just sort of... and then he just sort of ducked back down underneath for a while and said, I need to do...
Unless there must be a Jesus story with Wackadoodle. The sun is God.
Oh.
We need Chanticleer.
And they had to find the Jesus Chanticleer in Sin City.
I'm also surprised that I'm not the only one that's noticed this, and I was bringing this up while watching All Dogs Again. Here's another tendency that he has. And this has always stuck with him, as far as I can tell. Bluth tongue.
Bluth tongue?
Bluth tongue. Yes. If you look all throughout any animated sequence or short or film that he does, there's always some sort of denotation of a character being cute by the presence of a tongue hanging out.
Hell, there's plenty of it in Land Before Time with the shots of Littlefoot going.
No, I know what you mean. Actually,
even in Xanadu, I was just rewatching the fish sequence and whatnot, And the fish is just like...
Yeah, actually, I remember, like, the one thing that I know that is very, a signature animation style for Don Bluth is that for some reason, the lower jaw, it stays still. Because whenever they talk, it's always, like, the top of their heads that has to go up and down.
I'm a Muppet.
You know what I mean, guys?
Oh, yeah. I'm a munchkin. Okay.
Mike, is he dead? Is he asleep?
He's been taken. He's in heaven with the whippet, I tell you.
I think I've seen All Dogs Go to Heaven once or twice during my youth, but the film I remember the most was the sequel.
Oh no! We were going so well.
I'm sorry.
I didn't even talk about Judith that much. Come on, give me some slack here.
I
was good with that.
Mm-hmm. Well, you did good, man.
Yeah, see, even he agrees with me.
It was amazing. I was just laying here just listening to the whole thing. It was awesome.
Yeah. Give me a Secret of Nim too, please.
I mean, what's wrong with Charlie Sheen?
Sure about
as
that?
Charlie? Come on. Give Charlie Sheen some credit.
You do not replace
Burt
no.
Reynolds.
Like, yeah, Burt Reynolds wasn't a good singer, but at least he's a good actor.
But yeah. You don't replace Burt Reynolds with frickin' Dex Dog Detective, just saying.
You can't keep a good dog down.
Jeez.
You do not replace... All Dogs 2 just did everything wrong. I mean,
it's a retread.
No.
It's a retread. Retread.
You do not replace 1936 New Orleans with mid-1990s San Francisco out of the blue.
Seriously, how could Itchy survive that long and then finally choke on a chicken bone? It makes no sense.
Oh,
what, is there a time jump?
Okay. Okay, I'll buy that. But even when I was a kid, I hated it.
Actually, full disclosure, I didn't hate it as a kid, but I still liked the first one.
I was going to say, I saw the first one more as an adult. I avoided the second one because I'm smart.
Don Bluth hates you. Don Bluth hates you.
You rather watch his those mechanically made sequels? Trust me, that's the term he uses, made.
Okay, because that's the thing. It's like, Hi, by the way.
Hi.
Hello.
Yeah, you're in the corner.
Apparently we got Mike in the shadows.
Yes, I'm in the shadows just for a little while. But see, that's the thing with me. I'm trying to think. I've never seen Secret of Nim. I think I've seen bits and pieces of American Tale. I've seen, like I said, I've seen All Dogs Go to Heaven as a kid. And the next film we'll talk about that. But the only ones I remember is All Dogs Go to Heaven 2 and American Fievel Goes West.
Okay, you got me on Fievel Goes West. That was pretty good.
I was a different kid when it comes to Don Bluth. I guess I was more of a Disney kid more than a Don Bluth kid.
Yeah, I when I get to my movie, I will definitely be talking about my history, but yeah, I was more of a Disney kid.
I'm going to confess right now that I was kind of like, I was a Disney kid, but I was also a Don Bluth kid, but for all the wrong reasons.
Two words, Princess Daphne.
No. As a kid, no, it's not because of Princess Daphne. No. When I mean all the wrong reasons, I mean freaking Thumbelina and Troll in Central Park.
Oh.
See, I liked Thumbelina.
What? You had the hots for Rosie? That's wrong.
No, no, that's not.
No, that's wrong.
My That's day has it. Come.
Oh. That's not what I meant. God damn it.
You know, I can't wait for this.
You know, the weirdest thing is that, actually, here's a fun fact. Me and not too long ago, me and one of my friends, we got drunk and we decided to sing to the Troll in Central Park song. Like we had like a karaoke thing going, and we were just there. I like to close my eyes and all that we can see. Da, 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 da.
You know, that's almost as bad as them singing.
It feels so vicious to be and malicious, for I am Gnorga, the bitch of mean. I'm Gnorga, the queen of mean.
That's not a bad, like, give all the crap you want to Troll in Central Park. The songs are actually not that bad.
And to be honest,
yeah,
to be fair though, if I had to choose between of those two, I'd probably say Pebble and the Penguin was better.
Oh yeah. Pebble and the Penguin is definitely better.
Did somebody say Pebble and the Penguin?
Shit.
Yes. Petey, I'm about to talk about your favorite movie.
I swear it's not my favorite movie, I tell you. I don't like Pebble and the Penguin.
Oh, really? You don't like Pebble and the Penguin. What?
Back away, you foul beast. Back away, foul beast.
Well, it was meant to cater to your people.
Hey, look, I have your favorite movie.
I have a seal. I know how to use it.
It is horrible. I tell you, it's horrible. Get this. Get that shit out of my face. Get the shit out of my face.
Actually, Petey, I would like to know about your thoughts on Surf's Up 2.
Oh boy. So.
Petey rats.
Hold on. I gotta talk to my mother. Hold on. Be right back.
I thought you said I'm gonna go talk to my whore. I'm like, what the hell is this?
Devin has a whore? Where did this come from?
Devin, didn't you learn sharing this caring?
I didn't know! Bad if they had whorehouses in a G-rated All Dogs Go to Heaven movie.
That's one thing I was gonna mention. Is like, wow, it's one of the few. Thank you.
I thought Charlie said poorhouse, and then James like whorehouse. You say whorehouse, and G Raymond like what? I heard poorhouse.
Turn up the volume next time.
Oh God.
We would like to get to the movie.
I actually, you know what, Matt? I'm so excited for Surf's Up 2. I'm so excited for Surf's Up 2.
Oh, Matt. Really?
Yes.
Oh, really?
I love.
Is it because Penguin Page turns you on?
Yes. Yes. Yes, Matt. Yes. She is fucking hot in Penguin form. Oh, my God. I go, whoa, la, 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 la.
Okay.
But okay, so
dude, don't you know anything? Antarctic pussy is mighty cold.
Of course, but it always turns into hot steaming sex.
That's why.
I don't even know how we got into penguin porn. Like.
Because the pebble of the penguin is the worst case scenario for penguins everywhere. Because we don't give pebbles to each other. God damn it.
They're not pebbles, yours, man. They're kidney stones.
By the way, you want to know a true fact about pebbles and penguins is that there are some gold digger penguins. They like sometimes they'll flirt with penguins just to get the pebbles. That's a true fact, by the way.
Oh wow! I'm not surprised.
Now who has the horn? Why?
I'm saying she's a gold penguin, but she ain't messing with no broke penguin.
Anyways, what did you like about the pebble and the penguin?
Well, here's the thing. For those of you who are unfamiliar with the story, it's inspired by the actual dating ritual of Adélie penguins, in which a male penguin finds a nice-looking pebble for a female penguin, and they mate for life. The story The story follows Hubie, played by Martin Short, who's sort of this socially neurotic dweeby penguin who's got the hots for a girl penguin named Marina, and he's going to go out and find her the perfect pebble, and it literally falls out of the sky at his feet. It's a meteorite, comes down, lands in front of him, and it's what's inside the meteorite is a magic diamond. It's pretty much a chaos emerald. You know, you can look inside of it and see and see whatever you want to. And so does
Hubie have pebble control?
He would like to think so, but the next day he goes to present his pebble to Marina when he is accosted by an oversized Gaston-like penguin named Drake, played by Tim Curry, who is always amazing.
I love
who wants Marina instead? So he goes ahead and shoves Hubie off the iceberg. They all think that he's been eaten by a leopard seal, but instead he ends up on a boat, and where he meets up with a rockhopper penguin by the name of Rocco, played by Jim Belushi, and together they bust out and they head for Antarctica so that Hubie can give his girl the pebble. And that's what it is a feature-length global trek over how shall I say this? Materialism. Think about it. It's a movie that's all about materialism.
Exactly. That's what I hate about it. It's all about material possessions, goddammit.
But of course, it's not going to be a huge spoiler, because hell, it's even a lyric that's sung in the opening song. The lesson of the movie is, it's not the pebble, it's the penguin, which I think is, it's not an incredibly deep movie, I'm not going to fault it for that, but I do think that if there's anything that kids can get out of it, that's actually not a bad message. As for the overall how the film turned out, it's kind of interesting, not just from what I saw as a kid and what I saw as an adult perspective, but also the production perspective of this. This was at a point in Don's career where his studio was going bankrupt. And during this point, there were certain sequences that had to be rushed. They did get a lot of good work on this, I think. The 99% of the time what you're watching is the standard quality Don Bluth animation. And also everyone else is putting 110% into their performances. I think Martin Short is a really good comedian and singer.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, absolutely.
And I like the song. I like the songs from this movie. They open up on this one really lavish number that sort of feels like it sort of feels like the opening to a Broadway show. That's the impression that I get, because they're singing, there's guy penguins singing about, we want to find our perfect pebble for our girls and whatnot, and then they stop and talk and they're like, hey Hubie, have you found a pebble for your girl? Not yet.
Not really.
and so it's one of those cases where they mix up the singing with the dialogue, and it's sort of reminiscent of the It's sort of reminiscent of how Beauty and the Beast opens up, I think, a little bit.
Mm-hmm. A little bit, yeah. I could agree there.
Mm-hmm. But the production issues that they were having, they had to rush animated sequences towards other
Hungarian studios.
Hungarian studios. Mm-hmm. And my God, that there's one part in the film that is hard for me to watch. And that's I kind of like the Good Ship Misery sequence. Where they've got penguins and behind bars singing about being on a boat. And it only gets hurt when you look at certain background pieces where there are just lines of penguins standing completely still. And it feels like an unfinished movie at that point. And that's it's stuff like that. That's why Don and Gary Goldman had their names taken off from being directors on this, but they still had their names plastered all over it. You know, Don Bluth Limited Holdings.
Yeah. And you know what's actually very interesting? James, can you take out the who had the DVD?
Either.
Whoever had the DVD. Okay, can you just show it closely?
Sure.
Okay, look at this. Okay, look at this. Who the fridge is that bird? That little bird on the side.
Oh, that's one of his bird friends in the movie.
Yeah. No, but if you not that one. Not that one. Not the one that's really stupid.
It's a different color. You're right.
Yeah, it's like, and you look closely, like, he looks like he's just flying around going, dup, 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 dup. And, like, if you look, can you turn around, Devin? Can you turn that thing around?
Yeah.
Okay. I just want to check. Okay, no, because there's another one. There is another version. I don't know if it's in the VHS box or something, but it has, like, this little termite character. Like, he's often prominently shown on the covers and stuff like that, but he was never there.
Yeah, there are parts of this movie that feel like there were just scenes removed out of it for time purposes. I'm not necessarily the fact that they're unfinished, mind you.
No, but I think there is. I think there is like a new DVD version or something like that where it's a lot more polished and they fixed up a lot of the stuff.
Here's what they did. I'm glad that this movie got a Blu-ray release. Thank God this movie got a Blu-ray release, because when they stuck this on VHS and early DVD, they were not doing any favors by doing an open mat processing. That just made, you know, they widened the top and the bottom, and it made Hubie look like he was cut in half. It made certain props look like they disappeared. It's a disaster. So they put it on Blu-ray recently, and that's the version I was watching. And I'm looking around, and I'm just saying, no severed bodies. Thank goodness, this is it. This is how it was meant to be watched. I had to go pick up.
Right, here. Oh, sorry. Sorry, there. I just want to post this. I just found it.
Yeah. I always use a link. It can't be that bad.
No, yeah, I just put up a new one.
Oh, gee.
Why are you? Okay. I'm trying to find.
I'm looking at it right.
My God.
The page is loading.
Why are you stealing my thunder here with that image?
Look at that image. No.
The devil and the penguin. The devil and the penguin.
How dare you steal the thunder from James? He was talking, goddammit, man. You get the fuck out of here.
Hello, here we go. This is what I've been looking for.
Nice.
Oh, no.
And my computer froze.
Mm-hmm. Took over.
Oh, we can still...
Yes, I think
smooth
I...
move, Grace.
Yes.
Okay, what is that? He's not in the movie, Oh, you know what? There's one scene. There's one scene in the movie where he's, where they're at the Bahamas, and this character sort of comes on.
Yes, yes, I heard the little red termite dude.
Mm-hmm.
Really?
He tries to steal the pebble because it's a shiny thing.
Well, that's funny. Huh. I do remember that.
Well, Why would they?
I barely remember this guy.
Yeah, he's such an unimpressive and an unimpressionable character. Why would they stick him on the cover art?
Oh.
Hmm.
I don't know. It is fascinating.
But this movie and the birds that are hovering overhead. Yeah, those birds are they're Hubie's friends in the film, but I'm not sure if they belong in the Arctic. I think they were just slightly bettered up versions of those freaky termite children we saw in Thumbelina. but yeah, Pebble and the Penguin. It's a fun, mostly harmless type of movie that. I can look back on and every once in a while and say, yeah, that was fun. That happened. I liked it. I liked the attempted lavishness of it all. Devin, you have the DVD. I'm sure you have something.
The funny thing is when I saw this movie, I was at my grandmother's and I decided to bring it since I had the DVD. And because I found it when I was actually at a flea market, so I decided to go after it. And I went, okay, I need to see this. And I wasn't expecting it to be good, but I didn't expect it to love it as much as I did. I love how simple this story is. I love how cheesy and it's just a sweet story. And plus, I love Tim Curry. Tim Curry can do no wrong in my mind. Even Enchanted Christmas with... But I just adored how silly and cheesy it was. It's a cheesy movie. I mean, if I had to say of the 90s, early 90s Don Bluth films, before Pebble and the Penguin, I would definitely say my favorite. I haven't seen A Troll in Central Park. I got lucky and haven't seen it yet. But of all of them, Pebble and the Penguin's my favorite. Just because it's really cute, it's really sweet, and I like that message at the end, like you were pointing it out, how it's not the pebble, it's the penguin. It's where you're saying, okay, yes, you can give the best pebble out there, but if you're not a good person, or a good penguin, mind you, the girl's not going to fall for you. She's just going to think, oh, you're just being materialistic. But I like it. But I liked at the end where it's like, okay, there's this Gaston like guy that's pretty much a douche, even his voice by Tim freaking Curry. But I loved that ending with him getting Hubie and Marina getting together because they are a cute couple. I'm a hopeless romantic.
Yeah, and of course, let's not forget gravity-defying rock hoppers.
Yeah, and the one thing I will admit with Pebble and the Penguin, like, it is true that during Don Bluth's Dark Ages, this is the one that is the least bad. I will admit, the soundtrack is really, really good. I really am impressed by that. It can be real, like, the movie, I guess the biggest thing is that it can be cliche, but it's a really, really cheesy movie. This is probably around the same levels as something like Fern Gully, The Last Rainforest. Like, if you're able to tolerate that, then you're able to tolerate this. because it does have like some good things, some bad things, but they are really cheesy. The musical numbers are great. The animation, like, it's really good despite its problems. But if you have the updated version, then that shouldn't be an issue. But other than that, it's Don Bluth can definitely do better, but this is fine. But at the same time, I would like to mention, though, that this was, like, at the end of production, that was definitely rushed, considering that when Don Bluth and Gary Goldman got the opportunity to go and make a new movie in Phoenix, Arizona, they immediately ditched their studio in Ireland, like, while they were pretty much trying to finish things up at Pebble and the Penguin, and that was pretty much it there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's pretty much that. Oh, yeah, I do agree about the musical numbers as well. I remember getting one of the songs stuck in my head immediately after I watched the movie.
Now and forever, we'll do like birds do. We'll cuddle and coo and kiss.
Yes, Pebble and the Penguin is actually one of my favorites, despite Petey's opinion, which nobody cares anymore anyways, but...
Wow, look at how we get along together.
I like musical numbers like that one where it sort of feels like, again, even though Barry Manilow was doing the music and he's typically more pop, numbers like that sort of, they give it a very Broadway show type.
Yeah,
feel.
It's very Broadway-like.
I do remember that, actually. I don't remember the one song that gets stuck in my head. Do you know the one song where... Hubie is singing to, I think, Rocco, I think? He was singing the one song.
Oh, yeah, look how we get along together.
That one.
It's great that when we bend.
Yes.
Looks like we're two birds of a feather. Yeah. And it looks like I got me a friend. Now you try.
Yes, that song got stuck in my head.
It's a that was the... Every time I hear the name Rocco, I just keep thinking of Rocco's Modern Life for some reason.
Actually, they...
be very, very annoying. Listen, Hubie, I'm not here to try to sing songs. If you want to go back to your girl, well, why don't we go now?
Boy, Spunky, let me tell you, this penguin nuts. He thinks he can win the Charmers with a pebble. And it should be about him. Let me tell you, down in Australia, we never take that kind of thing out, eh?
Yeah, how is it that a girl loves you only by a pebble? It makes no sense.
Let me tell you, people in Attica, Spunky, are crazier than you think in the city.
Yeah, that number right there, I remember MGM was... MGM had a very short-lived slew of sing-along videos at that time. And they were trying to bite in the Disney market with the whole Disney sing-along songs and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And all I remember is an advertisement for it. They used that song in there as one of their big pulls, even though the movie didn't do very well.
You know what's fascinating? Now that I think about this, I remember... watching advertisements for, like, 20th Century Fox. I think it was Joyce. Let me see. Oh. Yeah, no, I'm sorry. MGM. When they released their Family Fun Edition. I remember, I was a little kid, and you know how you see the commercials for, like, if a big set of movies are coming out on VHS or whatever. I remember, one point... One of the commercials actually had this song playing from Pebble and the Penguin because Pebble and the Penguin was coming out. So I just remember that song used to get in my head and I never knew what movie it was from. But then when I saw the film years later, I was like, crap, is this movie? Oh, wow. I didn't know this until I saw the film, so I was very happy to have known that. I was like, that used to get in my head. I still love it. I need to see the film again, but I thought it was great when I first watched it. I fell in love with it. I thought it was cute and very cute, very enjoyable. my type of movie. Cute little penguins.
Mm-hmm. Penguins for the win-win.
Penguins for the win-win.
Yes. For the win. For the win. See, if you have not seen Pebble the Penguin, just please go check it out. Please go check it out.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Let's wrap it up with the last film of the night. Devin, take it away.
All right. Well, now we're going into my childhood. Well, this is the one movie. Here, I might as well just reveal it because I have the DVD anyway.
Hey, the classic Disney movie. Ooh, shit.
No, I am gonna kick your ass.
Sadly, this is based on a true story, but I'll let her explain because it's her choice.
Yes, well, okay. Here's the fun fact. Yes, actually, for years, when I was a little kid, I didn't know this was a Don Bluth movie. I thought it was another Disney movie. Yes, mm-hmm. I did. I was one of those people. It still pisses me off. But I saw this film at a young age. I was probably in my maybe elementary, middle school years. And I loved it. Like, a friend of mine had it. Like, a friend of mine I knew years ago had it. And she let me keep her VHS copy because she didn't want it anymore, and I really liked it. So I watched it a lot at home. And eventually, I loved it so much, I had my brother buy me the soundtrack.
Mm. For my book.
Yes, I loved it that much. This was one of those movies that is an interesting Don Bluth film, considering a lot of things. First, it was released in 97. Otherwise, during the Disney Renaissance. So...
96, actually.
Yeah, well, whatever.
97.
It was 97.
I'm looking at it. It's 97.
I was right. 97. Yeah, right. Don't mess with me.
Gene Siskel was still alive to see it.
Oh. Yes, it was 97. I would remember. But what made this interesting as Don Bluth film is the fact it's when people think of it, a lot of people do confuse it for a Disney movie. And I can understand why. It's following the Disney formula of the 90s. It's almost a 90s Disney formulaic fairy tale. Even though it's based off of the Romanoff family. Which, the film is basically about, like, what happened if Anastasia, the youngest granddaughter of the Romanoff, or daughter, I'm sorry, of the Romanoff family survived. And to see what would happen if she did live. And then, of course, goes also into these con artists that are going to try to woo the grandmother by having the music box and bringing the Anastasia lookalike and just pass her off as the real Anastasia. But then as the story progresses, it's going into how she really is the real Anastasia. And the story during the scene where they meet... the Dowager Empress's, I don't know what to call her. I always remember her name is Sophie, but I don't know what she is. I think she's, related somehow. I don't remember, but...
Dowager Empress Marie?
Yeah, no, never mind. It's hard to explain, but... But what was interesting is, how she... Anastasia's going into the story about how did she escape. And... Dimitri just has this look on his face like, wait a minute, that was right. Because he was the one that let them out and saved their lives. And I thought that was a great scene just because it really showed that, no, he's changing his heart. And I also thought, not only, the musical numbers in this film are great, but it's also interesting to know that, who are some of the biggest voice actor names that they got for this? Because, when you think about it, it is following the Disney formula. You know, you get the get big names in industry, especially later on in the Disney history.
We got Meg Ryan, John Cusack, Kelsey Grammer, Christopher Lloyd, Kirsten Dunst, Angela Lansbury. Yep. Kirsten Dunst is apparently young Anastasia.
Oh, I knew that.
And they got Angela Lounsbury. And, yeah.
Oh, do you know what? I have a dude know this fun fact. Well, when Christopher Lloyd was trying to record for Rasputin, he was originally going to try to sing the song In the Dark of the Night. But, you know what happened? His voice gave out on him. So Jim Cummings came in, and he flawlessly took over.
Mm-hmm. Jim Cummings, the guy that always flawlessly takes over whenever a bad guy villain's voice goes out.
Oh, yeah. Point, very, Jeremy Irons.
Very mm-hmm. true. This is the second film that he was able to flawlessly take over. And Liz Callaway was, of course, the singing voice for Anastasia, and Meg Ryan was the lead actress for Anastasia. I think it is interesting, like, yeah, John Cusack is Dimitri, and then they have this other guy named, like, Jonathan Bullsinger or something like that, who does the singing voice for Dimitri. It's just interesting how many actors they got that did not know how to sing, and they got different singers, but then they got Bernadette Peters and Angela Lansbury and Kelsey Grammer, who all knew how to sing. So it's kind of a funny mixed bag of who can mm-hmm. sing and who cannot.
Hank Azaria,
yeah. Well, he doesn't really sing, but yeah, he's a great voice actor.
Well, except in Bartok the Magnificent, but that's another story.
That's a different story, and I haven't seen that, so I can't really say anything.
It's kind of like a passable little addendum to Anastasia, if you like Bartok as a character.
Yeah, like, yeah, that is true. I think it's interesting, too, for me, personally. Like, a lot of people complain that this film is very much a historically inaccurate retelling mm-hmm. of the Romanov family and what happened to them. And I'm like, well, you guys, this is an animated feature. And how many films really go into how many films are that historically accurate, even if they're adult films?
Like, yeah, that's the thing, especially in the 90s, like Anastasia wasn't the only one. There were so many movies that were very loosely based, and some of them not necessarily get away with it. There are some that do, like, not much people complain about Mulan. Not much people complain about Little Mermaid, but there have been a significant amount of people who would complain about Pocahontas and also The Hunchback of Notre Dame. So, like, often there are those people that do complain about the historical inaccuracies and how it differs from stuff like that. But, like,
what's historically inaccurate about A Hunchback of Notre Dame? It's a work of fiction.
No, but I mean, like, how it differs from the book. That's what I mean.
Oh, okay.
The thing is with Anastasia is right from the get-go, it's already kind of a what-if scenario. It already goes far from it. Like, we know that in the real world, Anastasia is pretty much dead, like, right from the very beginning in the massacre. So, like, all these elements, like having Rasputin as the villain and all that kind of stuff, like, it can be loosely in, like, it can be loosely interpreted and haven't let it slide. Now, with that said, with Anastasia, I would say that out of all the animated features in the 90s, there are only two that I can think of El Dorado was not released in the 90s. Is it in the 2000s? Okay, yeah, so, like, with that said, there are only two animated features that I can think of that have successfully captured the Disney formula. Like, they managed to get it right. It is Anastasia and Prince of Egypt. Yeah, and with Anastasia, no wonder how there are so many people out there who would mistake this for a Disney film, because it got the formula right every single step of the way. Is like a Disney film, and this one captures it perfectly. But not only that, it captures it very well. It masks it to the point that it's entertaining. It's good. The songs are really great. The animation is beautiful. The characters, they have a sense of likability. And the story is really fascinating through and through. It feels original. It doesn't feel as cliched.
Oh yeah, you look through this movie, you can find little historical tidbits, and you know that they did some homework on this. It's
they
kind
did
of
some
like
research, yeah.
It's a kind of like National Treasure to an extent. Like the music box that you mentioned, that was a real thing.
Mm-hmm. Oh, actually, here's another fun fact. You know the one scene in the movie where the Dowager Empress and Anastasia are reunited and they're looking at reminiscing at an old photo?
Mm-hmm.
There's a little picture of this little girl that was sitting on a bench. That was a real photo mm-hmm. of her. Real photo. She drew that, actually. It wasn't... that was a real-life drawing that she actually drew. And for me, because I love history, I grew up loving both Pocahontas and Anastasia, and these were two films that really inspired me, partially, to go into history, to dive into the history of the Romanov family, or dive into Pocahontas' legacy. And, I mean, I know for me, it just fascinated me on how different they were. And I actually, fun fact, later on in my life, I actually did a presentation on the Romanov family. Now I know mm-hmm. a lot of facts about them now, which I'm not going into here, but it connected with me on a personal level, because yeah, it really is like the Disney formula. And the one thing I did notice, I actually had to think about this. Have you guys realized that the only Don Bluth film besides this one is Secret of Nim, where they have a strong independent woman?
Mm. That is true, actually.
Yeah.
Crap. She wasn't the focus of Tiny East. That doesn't count.
Yeah.
I still give that character props, though.
Yeah, I mean, still Mr.
Well,
Space.
Technically,
Trimming has to save her arms when she gets shot in the arm or something.
Anyone has to get saved when they get shot in the arm.
Well, yeah.
She never supported Planet Bob.
Well,
back to Anastasia.
Technically, when you think about Anastasia and Secret of Nim, they were actually based on something. With the other stuff like Land Before Time and American Tale and all the other... Well, actually, technically, there is one that you are missing, Devin. What about Thumbelina?
Well, I don't think...
She's not a strong, independent anything.
Yes! Yes!
Even I have to...
We can't add Thumbelina! It's just impossible!
See, I will agree with James and Matt on that one. Or I'm sorry, James and Matt.
Okay, no, I just realized...
Wait, I'm Matt now? I'm Matt now? Wow, this is an interesting twist.
You better go. Where's the hair?
I'm sorry.
Morgan, did you just get sexier?
Well, here it is. I'm gonna review Food Fight.
Oh my god, I'm extremely tired, but yeah, I always thought that was interesting. Yeah, I'm not gonna count Thumbelina only because yeah, she's not a strong, independent woman at all.
No, because I was thinking of like if there are other female protagonists in the new film, but I get what you mean. No, because I was mentioning how other like Don Bluth's other movies, they're not like they're more original films. With Anastasia and Secret of Nim, they're based on something. They already have a character that like is already a strong, independent woman. So, well, technically, you can not count Anastasia because they have to make her up a bit more, but you get what I mean.
What about Littlefoot's mother? I know she got axed
off. Protagonist.
I'm talking about the lead. See, that's why I don't count Thumbelina. Yes, she's the lead character, but she's not a strong, independent woman. That's what I said. I said strong, independent woman in a Don Bluth film. And there's only two.
Alright, so Anne-Marie doesn't count.
Well, no, because she's not the lead protagonist, Charlie Barkin is. But I always loved that, because that's actually something that I connect with the most, is I love women that are very strong and independent. and that's why I loved a lot of the Disney movie, 90s Disney films, and Don Bluth was able to follow that formula very well. And it's funny, I loved how Meg Ryan was not convinced to do this film at first. She was very unsure about, because Don actually really wanted her. He was like, who's the first person we should have play Anastasia? Don was like, oh, Meg Ryan. And, well, Meg Ryan had to be convinced to, because she wasn't sure about doing it.
Yeah.
She was convinced by Don. They did an animation sequence of a scene in Sleepless in Seattle. Mm-hmm. And they pretty much did the dubbing over that. And she was impressed. She was so impressed that she said yes. And I actually found this featurette on my DVD of Anastasia that actually dives into like how Meg thought, this is like a romantic comedy in a sense. And I actually have to agree with her. Because, for one, Meg Ryan's been in so many romantic comedies in the 90s. Just name one, you'll know it.
You got mail.
You got it. Shit. Okay, I'm sorry the way you said that, but it was just funny, because their banter, like, especially between Anastasia and Dimitri, is very much a romantic comedy banter, which I thought was great, but maybe that's just me. But overall, I think I love the voice actors, I love the music, I just love everything about it. It inspired me, and I know so much about this movie, so that's pretty much all I got to say about that.
Yeah, and going back to what you said in terms of, you know, historical accuracy, anyone will tell you that... that I'm a stickler when it comes to something like a biopic. Like I always have this thing about yet you have to try and do it justice, otherwise it comes across as some sort of propaganda piece, or it comes across as some sort of insult. It's the director's vision of who this person was as opposed to who they actually were. Morgan Wired.
Kill.
You see what I mean?
Kill.
You see what it does to people?
Kill.
You see what it does to people?
Yeah.
But with that Anastasia Balto, Pocahontas, and the whatnot, I give them a pass because You have to look, just be able to look at the front cover and realize what you're getting into is a fairy tale.
Yes.
I mean, there is no way in hell that what you're about to watch is in any way, shape, or form accurate. And if you're thinking that this is based on a true story when you pick up the cover, it's a cartoon.
Yeah, and you know the worst thing is that these movies, they would never get to be made today. Like, in nowadays, how people are so picky and they can easily be triggered by the slightest inaccuracies in any way, shape, or form, even if the work is fiction, like, they will go on a rampage. They would be absolutely outraged. So no matter what, even if it is Pocahontas or Anastasia or stuff like that, if they do a little bit of an inaccuracy, like, people would be livid. They would be legit mad and go on rants on social media and stuff. So it's only so the 90s was the only time period when it was okay to do these loosely based true stories.
Yeah.
Because like they can get away with it. It's an animated film. That's what you do.
Yeah,
I don't know. I still look back on Dragon the Bruce Lee story as one of the worst biopics I've ever seen in my life. But and that was the 90s. Huh? No, that wasn't animated. That was the 90s.
That's the problem. If it were animated, people wouldn't have taken it as seriously.
If you want to take the life of Bruce Lee and turn it into a kung fu movie, the least you could have done is at least make it feel like a Bruce Lee movie. No, they don't.
See, yeah, I have to agree with Matt on that. Like, where you can get away with a lot more likely to get away with loosely inaccurate films is animation.
Thank you. That's what I'm trying to say.
Mm-hmm.
It's true. Like, I know a lot of people that, like they will not, they will give Anastasia and Pocahontas a pass, but they will go after other live-action films, and they will nitpick and nitpick and nitpick. And I had friends like that. It was very amusing. I'm like, well, they're both historically inaccurate. And they were like, well, because I grew up with Anastasia. I grew up with Anastasia or Pocahontas or whatever.
Steve Jobs never had this conversation.
So, yeah.
So, Morgan, how's the kill?
If anyone hears news report about Bob Woodward getting shot in the arm, I didn't do it.
Watch out.
You made sure to wash your hands afterward, right?
Oh, yeah, I did.
Okay.
Good. Now, but yeah, I like Anastasia. Okay, while we're watching Anastasia, my Bluth tongue sighting was in Pooka, the dog.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Oh my god, that is a good point. I love her, a little adorable if you, dog, by the way.
Everything about this movie, you're right. For the most part, it feels very like a Disney film in terms of the character and designs. But what I'm looking at, and here is where they sort of, where the Bluthism sort of seep back in, is with all the human characters. It seems like they're constantly having reference models for everybody. I mean, the movements of the characters are just that fluid and that natural looking. Don did that as far back as Xanadu, and that I consider to be one of his trademarks. Even All Dogs Go to Heaven, that one sequence you were mentioning, Morgan, where suddenly the people are walking by and it's like, oh wow, the people look like they're really moving. That's sort of part of his charm. Here in Anastasia, the characters are designed to look like Disney characters very much, but they're designed to move like Bluth characters.
Mm-hmm.
I did find this out, like, during, you know, the opening scene where they're going with the horse carriages up to the palace. Well, mm-hmm. apparently Don and his team, like, they recorded a horse mm-hmm. carriage coming by yep. so that they could get the accuracy of the horse's feet and everything, so they could animate the horses correctly. Yep. So mm-hmm. that they could be as accurate as possible.
Yep, Pooka.
Yep. Uh-huh.
Pooka and Bartok are the only characters who I look at and say, yeah, this is pure Bluth right here. You have.
Are you sure this is Disney? Oh no, that's sound blue. That's sound blue.
I mean the. Oh, you're even cuter like that. But one of the charms with Bluth's character designs is his when he's designing a character that's cute, they're usually imperfectly cute. And that's kind of what I see Pooka as, is that he's so adorable, but he's got all the lines and imperfections going sort of in different odd, interesting places that you wouldn't necessarily see in a dog design. And, of course, the tongue. You're like, okay, puppy!
Oh, my God.
I'm going to throw a snowball in the air so that the dog can jump up and bite it. Ooh, it's so cute.
Hey, the dog.
Merchandising. Pooka the t-shirt. Pooka the coloring book. Pooka the flamethrower. The kids love that one.
Talk about your hot dogs.
Oh. Mike, you still alive in there?
No. Did I just bore him?
What did you say?
I think Mike has gone Betty by.
Yep. So, with that said...
I guess the final question to say is, how is Dragon's Lair going to hold up?
Well, it depends. We're going to wait and see, because with Dragon's Lair... the thing is that he's only doing a pitch for now. So, he, as you guys have heard, he has done a... last year, he did a Kickstarter that didn't work out on that website, so he went to Indiegogo, and at the end of the day, he actually got the original pledge that he wanted, and most of us actually did a contribution. I know I did, and
I was the only one that didn't.
You
make Dragon's Lair movie, you'll get the Don Bluth stare.
So basically, what we all did is that. what Don Bluth is planning is that he's going to go and do a movie pitch to make a Dragon's Lair movie, which it has literally been more than a decade since I've heard him talk about it. He wanted to do this for a long, long time, and finally he's going to go and actually do it. But now he's only going to do a movie pitch, so we'll have to wait and see if there's going to be a studio that's going to look at it and they want to do it, so they would give him the $70 million that he demanded for. However, I would like to add, there is something that I do like to add, that Don Bluth's popularity because of this is coming back, considering that he has done several appearances in other places. Like, he has been in several interviews, and of course, there was also the Nostalgia Critic appearance that really boosted his popularity again.
And he also has his own theater, for crying out loud.
Because during the 2000s, after Titan A.E., he has pretty much disappeared, but what he has done is that he was pretty much tutoring people on animation, and he also had his own community theater in Phoenix, Arizona.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, so that's where the whole theater thing was in his videos.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's interesting. I'm glad he's put those guys to use. Maybe they can be in the movie.
Now that'd be something.
Yeah.
I think I said it best. Between the two fundraisers that was coming up in December, Dragon's Lair and Mystery Science Theater 3000, while I'm really happy we're getting 14 new episodes of one of my favorite cult shows, I really want to see Don Bluth succeed this time. I really feel like something can be done here. He has a huge resource of ideas, all these drawings, all these sketches that they've been doing for decades, like Matt said. And just for once, just this once, I would so love to see a traditionally animated movie on the big screen. We've seen so many CGI movies, some really good, some surprisingly good, but for once, I just want to see that traditional art style one more time, if possible.
Oh,
I agree.
Mm-hmm. Same here.
More than one time, I'm sure, but this is gonna be one of those times when the master returns.
Yeah. I've played the game on my tablet. I really love it. I think there's a lot of potential here. I just can't wait to see if it all comes together.
Yeah. I finally finished the game 2 years ago. I think Morgan was actually a witness. I bought the Steam version and I was just playing one time live over him, and I was like, "Oh, this is, I actually beat Dragon's Lair. This is the first time in history."
And I just sort of, was this before or after I played it? Because I'm trying to remember. Because I was on this big kick in December and January, just kept beating it again and again and again. I'm just marveling at the animation techniques and everything.
Mm-hmm.
That just needs to see what Time Warp is like. I heard that one's really difficult.
Yeah.
Well, I heard it's easy.
Yeah. I remember when I was in the arcade one time, I was told... told by my brother I should never ever play that one because he said it was so weird. The first level is, as soon as I put the corners in, this fat lady came up and whacked me over the head with a with a bowling, rolling pin, and it was over.
Do they have that? I know they have Dragon's Lair on Blu-ray, but do they have Dragon's Lair 2 on Blu-ray as well?
Yes, that and Space Ace. I was actually kind of disappointed with Space Ace, to be honest.
It's not, like...
It's not as fun.
Nah.
The whole purpose of the game is to stay past the pubescent stage.
Though, to be fair, Don Bluth is the villain. That was kind of cool.
Oh, yeah.
You will not win.
Yeah, it was the only time when Don Bluth actually did a voiceover role. But yeah, at the end of the day, I'm definitely excited to see Dragon's Lair to be back on the big screen because, like, when you think about it, the last time I've seen a hand-drawn animated feature technically would be last year with the Iron Giant Signature Edition, and the last time that it was like a new animated feature was Winnie the Pooh, and that's kind of lackluster.
What about? Oh, you mean in theaters?
Never mind. In theaters.
Yes, some theaters.
No, because okay, no. If we're gonna count like ever, no, like that, no. We're not gonna get into that because I'm sure there have been tons of new hand-drawn animated features, especially with the
Secret of the Kells.
Yeah, Secret of Kells, Song of the Sea, all that kind of stuff. The Illusionist. I mean,
that's the thing. Those are all foreign produced.
Yeah, those are independent ones. But yeah, like something from Hollywood, something from the U.S., like something like that. That is rare. So, anyways, with all that said, I think that's going to be it with Cinema Royale. I completely forgot. What are we going to do next, guys?
I will tell you. Calm the fuck down.
Oh, yes. He's alive.
He's alive!
Oh my god! In the name of God, now I know what it feels like to be God.
Oh my god! I didn't bore him.
Yes, I'm alive. I took a short little nap. Thanks you. I'm sorry.
Hey! Maybe next year, April Fool's Day, we should take over the show.
Yeah, really.
We'll fire you next time.
Well, that's a good point.
I'm just kidding, guys. Yes.
We did get fired after all. What a twist! moving on.
Yes.
Go on,
Don Bluth. He's the greatest non-Disney animator. Well, he was one of Disney, but yeah, but he was the greatest.
He's one of the very few. I think the best way to put it is that Don Bluth is one of the very few people in this world that we can consider a master animator, one of the true champions of this craft. The only other people that I can think of that we can put in this category are like the Nine Old Men, the people in charge of the animated films of the Golden Age, like Fred Moore, Percy Pierce. Those people, Nine Old Men, the supervising animator, like Bill Till. Oh yeah, also Bill Tibble is on that list. The animators of the Golden Age of Disney, Glenn Keane and Richard Williams. That's it.
But you're forgetting Richard Rich.
Oh, of course, the great and wonderful Richard Rich, who brought us freaking Alpha and Omega, of course, pulled up. Anyways, but Don Bluth is definitely a masterful animator, and let us not forget about the other people who have worked with him, the ones who have definitely were by his side since the very beginning, including John Pomeroy and Gary Goldman. Definitely a wonderful team providing such legendary animated features, and Don Bluth was definitely the one person. If it weren't for him, animation wouldn't be the same, because he was the first one that woke up Disney, realizing that they got to do something, and really woke up Disney in order to have the Disney Renaissance and shape everything from there. Like, Don Bluth was actually the first ever serious competition that Disney had when it comes to animated features, because they realized that they were faced against like a powerful force, and that they were kind of at a low point in their lifetime. So Don Bluth is definitely a revolutionary and one of the most important people in animation. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
I remember watching Waking Sleeping Beauty. I forget who was the one that who was the narrator of that?
Don Hahn.
Yeah. He comes across with this remark about Don Bluth, and yeah, that's a great documentary, and I thought it showed a lot of great insight. Don Hahn is making some remark about Don Bluth saying he had a big head, he thought he was going to be the next Walt Disney, and I'm thinking to myself, you know what, that may be true, but you guys were the ones that were propping him up to be the next Walt Disney.
Mm-hmm. Because at Disney at the time, he was like climbing up the ladder. He was like, keep in mind, he became an animation director at for films like Peach Dragon and The Rescuers. If he stayed there, he would have been like a real Disney legend. Like he would have been
became
like
his own legend.
Like he would go and actually become a director, and you know actually make some memorable Disney films.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think he did better off without them.
No, I agree. Considering the time period, he absolutely did.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. He did the right thing in leaving. He did the right thing in leaving Disney because not only did he create some fantastic films in the 80s, but he also brought reason for them to step up, for Disney to step up and do the Disney Renaissance. Mm-hmm. So that's good enough to know that Don Bluth made a huge contribute to animation even without being at Disney, and that's a good accomplishment to have.
Thank you, Don. Thank you for everything.
We love you. We love you. I love you so much that I have 8 of your movies on DVD.
Oh my goodness. Count them off.
I'm not finished. I have 8.
Does that include Banjo the Woodpile Cat?
No.
We've got to talk about that.
Yeah, we didn't talk about that.
Banjo was a good short, I thought.
It was alright.
I'm a devoted fan.
I heard it supposedly got released with the Muppet Movie in a couple of places.
Yeah, that's
really?
I've heard that before.
Give these guys a round of applause, because these guys are truly amazing when it comes to talking about Don Bluth films.
I've done an entire look back of Don Bluth, so I know what I'm talking about.
So, just, I'm grateful that we had this episode, because I kind of opened my eyes to Don Bluth, and maybe I'll probably do a marathon of all these films.
Are you sure you open your eyes? Because they look pretty close to me.
I'd like to close my eyes and all that I can see. I forgot the lyrics, Fudge.
That was a bit tequila. Yep. Oh, absurdly green, yep. Birds singing songs.
And I was happy. Oh, and absolutely green.
Oh my god.
If you're a Batman, then I'm Groot.
Yes. I'm sorry, I had to do that somehow without being so obvious. Oh, I guess I am obvious. I know I'm so tired. So the next episode is obviously a look back at Batman throughout films, whether it's animated, live action, or what have you. So yes, we're checking a look at it.
Oh my god.
Take a look at a Batman.
I'm Batman.
This is Batman.
So, yeah. Take a look at Batman.
Tell me, did you bleed? Because I got a band-aid.
I got nothing.
So, yes. You guys, we'll dive into anything Batman, live action, animated, and the character, and what makes Batman the beloved hero of DC. Like, why does everybody love Batman so much? And we're not going to answer it tonight. Do not say it. Save it for next time. So, yes. Till next time, this has been Cinema Royale. Sorry for the lack of me. It's been a crazy day. Don Bluth for the win. And good night.
I am Groot.
Ciao for now.
See you later, dudes.
See you later, beautiful people.
Thanks, Bluth.
Thank you.
Thank you.